discussed before they came whether I would accredit that report as the unquestioned truth of the situation and refuse to admit them, cancel the appointment, or whether, in view of the extremely delicate relations, I would leave open the one chance in 10 or more that the report was not correct. I proceeded to receive and confer with them, and I felt that the chances were altogether, virtually, that the report was true. So the proposal they made was comprised of a few pages defining the Japanese attitude, just the reverse of what it was. It was peace, peace, peace. And then they took our attitude up and defined it as just the reverse of what it was. Well, I felt, in view of the extreme probability that the Pearl Harbor report was true, I felt like taking liberties in talking to them about their government. That would have been a little undiplomatic in ordinary times.
Well, Inspector, do you have any...
Program. He will cause the War Department General Staff to prepare the necessary plan. I think.
Well, following that report,
the equipment there and the number of troops were so inadequate that no defense against a first-class power was conceivable. It would be just a desperate sacrifice. I'm confused at the moment. I don't recall.
By the strain between Japan and the United States?
My best recollection is that it was, but we say here, we do not anticipate immediate hostile reaction by Japan to the use of military means, but you are furnished this information in order that you may take appropriate precautionary measures. That they utilize all available time on this specialized training and the men not be left without assigned duties, particularly during the maneuver period. I suggest that you prepare a separate phase for alert plan based on the assumption that the Air Force has been destroyed and a hostile landing effected. This plan could provide for the use of the necessary Air Corps personnel for ground defense and afford a means of indoctrinating them in ground defense tactics. It should, however, for the present at least, be subordinated to their own specific training requirements. It would appear that the best policy would be to allow them to concentrate on technical Air Corps training until they have completed their expansion program and have their feet on the ground as far as their primary mission is concerned. War Department Training Circular 47, which was issued July 18, 1941, can be accepted as a guide except in extreme situations.
Situation and the capacity with the material they had to resist such an attack successfully.
The Hawaiian garrison on the Army side was short of four engine bombers, only having 12. It was short a few three-inch anti-aircraft guns, and it was short more seriously in lesser calibers of anti-aircraft guns. It had been built up to a considerable extent in fighter aircraft. It had a moderate radar setup in the portable, of the portable type, then functioning. It had what I thought were ample troops to defend the beaches successfully against a landing attack. The military forces on Hawaii were in numbers and in equipment more nearly up to the desired standards than any other installation in the Army. Sufficiently established and equipped and organized to prevent a landing and to successfully resist an air attack and to defend the naval base. I was always of the opinion, as is indicated particularly by my letter to General Short of February 7th, I believe, that the principal problem there was to be prepared against an emergency of a surprise attack, which might come at any time, presumably with the least possible advance notice. In that letter, I stated, if you recall, quote, "My impression of the Hawaiian problem has been that if no serious harm is done us during the first 6 hours of known hostilities, thereafter, the existing defenses would discourage an enemy against the hazard of an attack. The risk of sabotage and the risk involved in a surprise air raid by air and by submarine constitute the real perils of the situation. Frankly, I do not see any land..."